And good afternoon to all of you. First, I would like to thank the organizers of this workshop for inviting me. Today, I'll be talking on what we have recently done towards development of a comprehensive model for estimation of spray characteristics. Yesterday, Professor Mungia, he highlighted the importance of computational approaches in the design process for combustion as a whole. So, if you now look at the process, the combustion process, most of the times we are using liquid fuel, and for liquid fuel, if we are really trying to optimize the process, it's not just enough to design a good combustor. You have to design a tailor-made injector. Very often you need a very innovative design for injector as well. So very often you have to design an injector itself. So and many of the phenomena which many of the things which Dr. Mungia mentioned yesterday, they are like instability or startup characteristics. These are the things. These are some of the things where the spray characteristics play a major role. So therein comes the importance of the injector. And as we all know that compared to extensive experimentation, CFD is now very becoming a preferred and cheaper alternative for experimentation. Okay. So if you look at the spray combustion scenario, it is very well recognized that one of the important missing link in the spray combustion CFD is the initial droplet size and velocity distribution. Once you get that, beyond that, it's now it's fairly standardized how you take care of the CFD codes are fairly standardized to take care of the remaining things. So there are how to get that in the initial size and velocity distribution is an important question, and as Professor Lee just now showed that the size and velocity distribution, they are themselves very important. Especially if you're looking at issues like hydrocarbon emission and things like that. For example, if you have in most cases we don't have a single droplet size. We have a spectrum of sizes of droplets, the compact designs of combustors, it may so happen that although the bulk of the droplets are evaporating, maybe the largest ones are not completely evaporating, or by that it's the time it's taking for evaporation, it's not getting enough time to get mixed or burned. So they can very significantly contribute to emissions like unburned hydrocarbon, carbon emissions and things like that. So it's not clearly it's not enough to just the traditional approach is to have a workaround from this about this size and velocity distribution by working with one of the mean size distribution, which is one of the mean size different means that Professor Lee was just mentioning, but that alone may not be sufficient, because the two ends of the spectrum, they can also significantly contribute. So the polydispersity is a big issue. So then to do a CFD analysis, you need this initial size and velocity distribution. Sometimes people go for some experimentation to get the velocity size and velocity distribution, but there are at least two situations where they can be difficult. So for example, when you are designing a a new injector, so then you need a comprehensive predictive model with minimum dependence on empiricism, and also the comprehensive models can be useful for high temperature, high pressure situations that you would normally encounter in combustions where experimentations can be difficult. Okay, so the comprehensive model, the way I am going to present it, it will consist of the, I mean, this is the basically the standard process of atomization. The liquid comes out in the form of a sheet that gets destabilized and breaks up into ligaments, and those ligaments get further destabilized and break up into drops. So the comprehensive model will have three modules basically. One is the internal hydrodynamics of the injector, basically a CFD, standard multiphase CFD module, which will take in the injector geometry and the flow conditions as input and give the sheet thickness, sheet velocity, cone angle, these kind of things as output, which will be fed to the second module, which is the sheet breakup model, and that will give the breakup length and mean droplet diameter. And then we need some model for getting the getting the distribution size and velocity distribution. Nowadays there are some works where the detailed numerical simulation that gives rise to the different size of droplets, and so this third module is not separately treated, but the third module that itself is there is a stochastic nature of it, so it's questionable how good the deterministic models would be for that kind of situation. So to get an overview, so what we did, so this is the same thing, this first part, this is geometry dependent, and we implemented that in fluent environment. It could be any other commercial or any other standard CFD environment. But the second and third parts, which are not geometry dependent, to a large extent they are geometry independent. So so if we now compare our approach and what our model does compared to some of the standard state of the art approaches available in the market, is that if you take a commercial software like Fluent, they also follow a somewhat similar approach, but for the liquid sheet breakup they consider only a planar sheet, whereas we consider a cylindrical liquid sheet with swirl and non-axisymmetric modes. We shall show its importance. And similarly for the spray characteristics, they use a predetermined spread factor, but in our case we can determine the spread factor directly from our analysis. Okay, and then we also did some experiments to validate some of the elements of what our model predicted. The Sartre, the ones in red, Sartre, they are the ones which for which we have the mechanism, the tools for validating in our lab. Okay, so to coming to the first module, it's the internal hydrodynamics of the injector. It investigates the detailed flow field of the two-phase flow. Nowadays, most of the people use Eulerian formulation like VOF for this. We also followed it. So the results that I will be presenting, we did it for a particular class of injectors, which combines some of the features of pressure swirl and air blast atomizers. So like a pressure swirl, we have the fuel and air inlet in the form of tangential inlets, but like air blast, we have air streams on two sides of the fuel stream. So if we go for a 3D model, the inlet boundary condition is fairly simple. It's the inlet velocity would be the flow rate divided by the port area, but that would because it's a, we intend to use it as a design tool, so we just try to see whether we can go for a simplified axisymmetric model. Actually, we got the this idea of equivalence from a series of works by Professor Milind Jog of University of Cincinnati. So what they did, we also tried to, they did for pressure swirl atomizers, we applied it for our geometry. We're considering the equivalence of axisymmetric, considering the preserving the tangential inlet velocity, radial, I mean, conserving the angular momentum, kinetic energy and mass, we found out these quantities which we used in our axisymmetric model. I mean, the gains were expectedly enormous. For example, for the same geometry, for the same conditions, the 3D model took us about a day. Computation, the axisymmetric model took less than an hour. So, but the results you can see, at least for the cases we investigated, the 2D and 3D models give practically identical results. We also validated these results both with literature data, I mean data from the literature, and also from our own in-house experiments, and in both the cases we got good results, good agreement. Now coming to the, I mean there are more validations, I am just squeezing everything into this time. So now coming to the second model, which is where we used a linear stability analysis. We also used nonlinear stability analysis for similar things, similar work. So in the linear stability analysis, we assumed our geometry was an annular liquid sheet sandwiched between an inner gas layer and an outer gas layer, and we provided axial and swirl velocity components to each one of them, and there was provision of both with respect to the liquid stream, there is provision for co-swirl and counter-swirl for both the inner and outer air streams, and we also had provisions for axisymmetric and non-axisymmetric perturbations. So how the two modules connect? The CFD, the first module predicts the velocity profile, the axial and the swirl velocity profile, which we averaged across the across this area, across the exit planes, to get the average axial and swirl velocity profiles profiles in our model. Okay, we also, because we are interested in finding out some of the newer features, so what we did, we also tried to investigate what would be the effect if the air stream or the liquid streams, they are recessed with respect to the outer air stream. So in this case, we get a recessed air stream, which we call a recessed configuration, and this is like a film where in this case, this wall, the wall separating the liquid and the outer air stream, extends up to the end of the injector. But here, in between the two, but the liquid inner air stream, the conduit for the inner air is ending earlier. So here we have a liquid film kind of thing. So here we did some validation exercises again, some standard dispersion curves with literature. Then we did some experiment, compared it with some experiments also to get the most critical frequencies, and we got a reasonably good agreement for most of the cases. So with the effect of confinement, we saw, I mean, I'm not going into the details of it, but we saw that this effect of confinement can play a major role in the breakup process. Similarly, the pre-filming can also play a major role, but the important thing is that for the recession and the pre-filming, the two configurations I showed, the liquid swirl plays an opposite role in the stability. Again, I'm just skipping the details physics, and this is again a very interesting result. In the four figures, we increased the swirl strengths, and we found that as we increase the swirl strength, the dominant mode switches from the axisymmetric to the helical mode. So this clearly shows that a planar sheet kind of analysis may not be adequate. Okay, so now we did some experiment and found that, I mean, the role is that one can intuitively understand that if the for situations which will have higher growth rates, we should have the lower breakup lengths and vice versa. So first, we compared the nature of the nature of the breakup length, length predicted by predicted, I mean, obtained from experiments. I mean, where we saw a non-monotonic kind of dependence on the outer air flow rate. So to confirm whether similar thing we saw in the simulations or in our model also, we saw that our model also showed that there is a minimum at some intermediate outer air flow rate, there is a minimum growth rate of instability, which agrees well with the observation of the maximum breakup length, increase in breakup length. Okay, but now comes the question. So the qualitatively we get the agreement, but how to get the breakup length from linear stability analysis? If we do a non-linear stability analysis, we can directly get it from, but that becomes more, much more complicated calculation. So from linear stability analysis, this is how people try to get it. The breakup length is proportional to, is obtained like this. But the question is, this omega max is the maximum growth rate which can be found from the dispersion curve. But the question is, how to get this eta b by eta 0 ratio? That is, eta b is the amplitude of disturbance at the breakup point, and eta 0 is the amplitude at the initial amplitude. For planar sheets, this value is well established in literature as 12. But for annular sheets, Shane and Lee, they approximated it as the mean radius of the annular sheet, but it's not very standardized. In a recent work, relatively recent work, it was this value was obtained from experiments. We also followed that route. Sorry. So here we saw, this L varying as 1 by omega max, that showed that there has to be an inverse relationship, and that we saw reasonably well. From our in-house experiments, we saw that the validation and the value is in the range of, this ratio is in the range of 1.5 to 2.5. So using this value, we got some breakup length. And then the next question was to get the mean diameter, so the size of the ligament diameter. So for, in the literature, we took from the literature, there were expressions for pressure swell and air blast types of atomizers. So from there we could get the ligament size, and then again from the literature we can get the mean drop size from the ligament diameter. Okay, so these are the relations. You can see, there is some disagreement in the middle region, but in the end regions the agreement is quite good, and within the envelope of 1.5 to 2.5. I mean, this is getting this ratio of this amplitude. This is one of the major uncertain areas of uncertainty in this kind of analysis. Okay, so coming to the third part, is the droplet size and velocity distribution. We used a formulation which is known as maximum entropy formulation. Well, what it does, it this Pij, I mean, the entire size and velocity spectra is discretized into a number of size and velocity classes, where I denotes a size class and j denotes a velocity class. So Pij denotes the probability of finding a droplet in the ith size and jth velocity class. So this maximum entropy formulation does that, this information entropy, the distribution which would maximize this information entropy subject to certain constraints would be the most probable distribution. And the constraints are obtained from the conservation mass, momentum and energy conservation equations. And for and there we need the information about the mean drop size and the breakup length. sorry. Okay, first again we obtained from the stability analysis. First we again validated our results with some of the experimental results from literature, and we found that the agreement is quite good. I mean, for example, in this case, these are the experimental results of one group. They are simulation by the same group. Our simulation, in fact, gives a better agreement. So now this is the experimental setup that we design in our lab, and so we opt for different flow rates. We obtain these different breakup regimes. I described this in the last meeting more about this. So these are some of the experimental results from size and velocity distribution, and some of the experimental results for breakup lengths and soil orientation. These are some of the experimental results, but these are not directly part of the predictive model. These are the ones which we use for validation. So finally, what we did, I'm just presenting only one case in where we saw that our comprehensive model predicted a mean diameter size of 5.72 micron, whereas from the PDP analysis, from experimentally, we found it to be 7.65 micron. Considering the uncertainties involved, this is a very good agreement. So this basically summarizes what we did. So finally, acknowledge the financial support from GTRE and ISRO. My colleague Professor Sean Rendushan, he is here, and Professor Amitabh Dutta, and our students. These are our PhD students. Shovik has already submitted his thesis, and there are many others, including a lot of undergraduate and master's students. Before just closing, I would just like to mention about some of the things that we do other than this. We work on combustion dynamics and atomization and sprays. This is a long list, so I have put an etc. at the end, but this etc. is more of, it's not just in not just a compression of our activities, it is also an acronym for what we do: experiments, theory, and computations. Thank you.
Excellent work. What I'd like to know is that yes, 7 and 5.72 is not a huge difference in some ways, but if it's fed into the combustor, it will make a significant difference to the combustion evaporation rate.
Sorry.
And I'm wondering, have you narrowed down or done any sensitivity to say where most of that uncertainty comes from?
No, we have not done it systematically, but if you go look at the way we have done it, the major area of uncertainty that lies in the second module, that means the breakup module. Mm-hmm. So where we have used linear stability analysis, things can improve a little bit with nonlinear stability analysis, but there also you have some uncertainties. Like in nonlinear stability analysis, you have to make an assumption of what will be your initial disturbance amplitude. So those things are not very easy to obtain. Even if you go for a detailed numerical simulation, DNS kind of thing, there also you have to give that as an initial condition. So, and here the initial disturbances are not generated, systematically. It comes out from the, comes out as a, spontaneously from the experiment. So it's, a priori, it is very difficult to say what is the, what would be the initial disturbance. Maybe through some very careful and extensive experimentations, we can get more. We can get wiser on that, and those things can improve our analysis. So, our plans are we want to extend it to more detailed nonlinear simulation, nonlinear stability analysis, and numerical simulations, and see how things improve. So that's why I agree with you, and that's why I said 5.72 and 7 point something. It's reasonably good only. I couldn't say it's very good.
Excellent work, Achintya.
Yeah.
Very good work. Just one comment, you know, like when you have this linear stability, can you come up with some simple model which can be used in more comprehensive, you know, simulations?
Yes, actually the linear stability analysis, after a lot of algebra, you just come up with a an algebra, one or two algebraic equations, which has to be solved, non-linear algebraic equation, which has to be solved using Newton-Raphson kind of thing. I mean, it can be a, it can involve complex quantities, but still it is solvable. So, so that way, it should not be very difficult to plug in with more detailed simulations.
Following that, is it possible to handle, for example, multi-component non-thixotropic materials like metal slurries?
I mean, in principle, yes. I mean, the thing is that only is, I mean, for the each of the models, particularly for the stability analysis, we have to work on developing a model, because this is taking some, picking up relevant models and stitching them together. That's what the comprehensive model is basically doing. But to improve that, I mean, for specific requirements, those things can come up.
It's really useful because, you know,
It would be very useful.
The fuels now, the easy way to go is to have a metallic slurry in it.
That would be very useful.
The CFD simulation that you did using ANSYS, they were laminar simulations?
No, they were.
What kind of simulations were they?
They were. We used standard K epsilon models.
K epsilon models, or the flow was turbulent.
Yeah, those, the flow velocities are, because of the narrow passage, with the flow velocities were pretty large.
So that itself, you know, will create a lot of uncertainty.
That's true. But
so you have uncertainty right there.
Yeah.
And then you take those profiles and put into your linear stability analysis code. Now, doing the, you said you can do the nonlinear stability. Nonlinear stability codes are extremely, I mean, I don't know whether you will develop your own code or will get some from somewhere. They are extremely complex. I mean, they are not simple.
Yeah.
And I was just suggesting that you have this discrepancy, like 7 point something or 5 point something, and you have that ratio, you know, eta b over eta zero.
Right.
Now, if you take that attitude, that to fit the experiment, and you said that nobody knows the value of eta b over eta zero for asymmetric flow.
Right.
It is well established for a two-dimensional.
Right.
So suppose you postulate that in order to match the experiment, this should be the value of eta b over eta zero.
Yes, yes.
Right? And you, and those experiments are repeatable, then you can make a case,
right,
or argue case, that that should be the final verdict. Instead of eta b over eta zero equal to 12, it should be this value.
Right.
Don't you think that argument makes sense?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I mean, we are, I mean, this is also something we are trying to look at. I mean, looking at more, generating more experimental data and say experimentally obtained breakup length, and then doing this analysis and seeing what would be the kind of eta b by eta zero for each case. I mean, to fit, putting in the formula and getting it and see what kind of scatter we are having.
Because
for
eta b over eta zero for accessibility case is well established by experiment, that would be a very good contribution.
Yeah, yes.
Thank you.
So, thank you, Professor Mukhopadhyay, for a very nice talk. So, we'll